Hello all. Today we will learn and understand one of the important laws of fluid mechanics, that is a hydrostatic law. Have you ever wondered why are dams broader at the bottom and narrower at the top? Do you know that the fitness band has underwater depth limitation? Why does a manufacturing company restricts user to use the band beyond certain depth inside water? Hydrostatic law will help you to answer all these questions. So let us first understand what is hydrostatic law. This law mainly deals with the variation of pressure inside the fluid which is at rest along vertical direction. Say for instance, on one sunny day, you went to a swimming pool. You jumped into a pool with an intention to touch the bottom wall of the pool and come up again. Now, during your journey, say at a depth of Z1 meters from the water surface, the pressure felt by your nose is P1 Pascal. And further at a depth of Z2 meter from the surface, the pressure felt is P2 Pascal. So now, what do you think about the values of P1 and P2? Whether P2 is greater than P1, or P2 is less than P1, or P2 is equal to P1? Our intuition may give us an answer that the pressure felt by us will be higher when we go deeper into the water. So with this, P2 must be greater than P1. So the question is, how much greater is P2 in comparison to P1? Let us find an answer to this. Imagine a cylindrical shaped fluid element with a cross-sectional area of capital A and a height of small h. Now, since the entire water in this pool is at rest, it is in equilibrium. And therefore, this cylindrical element of water is also in equilibrium state. Now, since this element is in equilibrium state, we can say that the forces acting on this element in vertical direction must cancel each other's effect. And so, the summation of all the vertical forces acting on this element must be equal to zero. Now, this element is subjected to the surface and body forces. Now, surface force here is in the form of pressure force applied by the surrounding fluid molecules. The pressure force is always compressive in nature and always acts perpendicular to the surface. So, these are the three main surfaces of the cylindrical element where the pressure forces are acting. Out of these three, top and bottom surface of the cylinder are such where the pressure force is aligned in vertical direction. Say capital F1 be the pressure force acting on the top plane. We know that the pressure on the top plane is P1 and the surface area is capital A. And therefore, the force F1 will be equals to P1 into capital A, which acts in downward direction. Similarly, let F2 be the force on the bottom plane where pressure is P2 and again the area is capital A, and therefore F2 is equals to P2 into capital A, which is acting in the upward direction. Now let us look at the body force. The only body force acting on this element is the gravity force, or you can say a self weight of the element. Weight W of the element always acts in downward direction, and we know that W is equals to mass of the element into small g, that is gravitational acceleration. Now, mass of this element can also be calculated as the product of density of the fluid into the volume of this element. So W will be equals to rho V into g. Now, this is because we know density is the ratio of mass by volume, and therefore mass is equals to density into volume. Now further, if we expand volume V, as the product of area capital A into the height of the cylindrical element. So W finally becomes rho into A into H into G. Let us now substitute these three forces in this equation. We will use the sign convention where we will consider the force in the upward direction to be positive and the force in the downward direction to be negative. So capital F2 being in the upward direction is considered to be positive, and F1 along with weight W are in downward direction, and therefore they are considered as the negative forces. So therefore F2 minus W minus F1 equals to 0. And if you take W and F1 on the right hand side of the equation, you will get F2 is equals to W plus F1. Now substituting the values of F1, F2 and W in this equation, we have P2 into A equals to rho A H G plus P1 into A. Now taking capital A common from the right hand side, we have P2 into A equals to A into rho G H plus P1. A gets cancelled from both the sides. And finally, P2 will be equals to P1 plus rho GH. So, look at this equation. It clearly signifies that P2 is greater than P1 by the amount equivalent to rho GH, where rho is the density of the fluid, G is the gravitational acceleration, and H is the vertical distance between location 1 and 2. Now this equation in general can be rewritten as pressure at lower altitude point equals to pressure at higher altitude point plus rho gh. This is because point P2 is at lower altitude and P1 is at relatively higher altitude. And this finally is the hydrostatic law. And with the help of this law, one can relate pressure at two different points that are vertically apart in a static fluid having the constant density. Say for instance, at point capital A, which is located at Z1 meters of depth inside water, the pressure is Pa equals to 1000 Pascal. Now the pressure at point capital B, which is located 2 meters down from point A, is not known to us. So one can use hydrostatic law to figure out the pressure at point B. So pressure at lower altitude point equals to pressure at higher altitude point plus rho gh. Now here point B is at lower altitude and point A is at relatively higher altitude. So we can rewrite this equation as pressure at point B equals to pressure at point A plus rho gh. Now in this equation, pressure at point A is known to us, which is 1000 Pascal. Rho is density of the fluid filled between these two points, which in this case is water, and therefore rho for water equals to 1000 kg per meter cube. G is gravitational acceleration, whose value is 9.81 meter per second square, and small h is the vertical distance between point A and B, which is 2 meters. So therefore PB will be equal to 1000 plus 1000 into 9.81 into 2. And finally PB will be equals to 20620 Pascal. At even higher depth, say at point capital C, which is 3 meters down from point capital B. And again PC is not known to us. So we can deploy hydrostatic law to figure out pressure at point C. So PC will be equals to PB plus rho GH. Again PB is 20620 Pascal. Rho is 1000 kg per meter cube. G is 9.81 meter per second square. And small h is 3 meter. So PC equals to 20620 plus 1000 into 9.81 into 3. And finally, the value comes out to be 50050 Pascal. So pressure at point C is 50050 Pascal. If you look at these values, it clearly says that at higher and higher depth, the pressure increases linearly. And the rate of increase in pressure with respect to depth is equivalent to the specific weight of the fluid. So this is the general statement of hydrostatic law. And this mathematically can be written as d by dz of pressure equals to rho g, where d by dz of p represents the rate of increase in pressure with respect to depth z, and rho into g represents the specific weight of the fluid. Now this is the more general form of hydrostatic law. The earlier one can be used only for the incompressible fluid, but this equation is valid for compressible and incompressible fluid both. So now, I hope you might have got the answers to the questions raised in the beginning. Why are dams broader at the bottom and narrower at the top? So, as per the hydrostatic law, the pressure acting on the wall of the dam increases linearly as we go deeper and will be maximum at the bottom. Therefore, in order to resist the effect of larger pressure forces at a higher depth, the dams are broader at the bottom. The same is the reason of why does fitness band has depth limitation. Fitness bands can resist water up to certain limit of water pressure, beyond which they are unable to resist the water. Therefore, they are not advisable to use during deep diving. With this, I end up this session. I hope you understood the physical significance of hydrostatic law. Hope to see you in next session. Thank you.